Let's go, girls.
Hello, and welcome back to Feminist Cocktail Hour. I'm JC, and today we're making a sort of patriotic feminist cocktail and a patriotic feminist bite to match. Our bite is a red, white, and blue-schetta. To make it, you're going to need some Italian bread, some roasted carrots, which I'll get into, purple carrots, some balsamic vinegar, some goat cheese, and some tomatoes. Our cocktail is an Amerigin Corbin. To make it, you're going to need some gin, of course, as well as some Bing Cherries, some blueberries, some simple syrup, and some lemon juice. Now, this cocktail, an Amer-gin Corbin, is a riff on a Tom Collins, and actually sort of a riff on another drink called an American Collins, but I am calling it an Amer-gin Corbin in order to honor Margaret Cochran Corbin. Who's Margaret Cochran Corbin, you ask? Oh, well, why don't you go wrangle up all those ingredients, and I will tell you a tale. So if you're anything like me, and by like me, I mean a musical theater major, then maybe you spent this past weekend streaming Hamilton on Disney Plus and watching the OG revolutionary musical 1776 on your VHS. That's right. Now, if you watched these films, then you probably noticed that all these Revolutionary War stories are a total fucking boys club. They're stories about Hamilton and Burr and Jefferson and Franklin and Adams. And sure, Abigail gets some nice tunes in 1776, and Eliza even gets the last word in Hamilton. But if you watch these films, you would think that the entire revolution was basically, you know, fought by dudes. Enter Margaret Cochran. Now, Margaret Cochran had a rough childhood. She was born in like 1751 in what is now Franklin County, Pennsylvania. Interestingly, I actually lived in Franklin County for a few months a couple years back when I was doing a play there. Back in those days, it was like totally unsettled territory. And in the 1750s, it was even worse. I kid. But no, seriously, when I lived there, I have never seen so many Confederate flags. What the fuck goes on in southern Pennsylvania? Anyway, when Margaret lived there, when her parents came there, they were immigrants from Ireland settling territory that belonged to, you know, other people. At that time, it was the Shawnee tribes and the Susquehannock tribes that probably lived in that area. I'm not 100% sure on this because, you know, the people living there at the time weren't like really fastidious about keeping records regarding the tribes that they were stealing land from. Now, this may be one microaggression, or let's face it, macroaggression, that led to Margaret's parents' untimely deaths. While Margaret and her brother were off visiting relatives, her family's home was victim of a Native tribe raid. Her father was murdered, her mother was likely kidnapped, raped, murdered, never heard from again, and Margaret was 5 years old and orphaned. She and her brother went off to live with their uncle, and that's just about all we know about Margaret Cochran Corbin's childhood. This seems like a fitting moment thereby to, I don't know, take a look at our food. Okay, so we're gonna start the way any bruschetta starts, by thinly slicing some Italian bread and then putting it in our toaster oven or oven and giving it a nice, you know, light toasting. My toaster oven turned out to be better for more than just toasting bread, though. I also used it to prepare my carrots. I thinly sliced some purple carrots. I tossed them in some honey, olive oil, rosemary, and salt, and then roasted them for about 10 minutes until they were just a little bit tender. Now, with all of those ingredients prepped, I am ready to start assembling my bruschetta. While I'm making that happen, I'm gonna tell you what happened to Margaret Cochran. So, when she turns 21, Margaret marries a farmer named John Corbin. It's about 1772, and the situation in the colonies is obviously becoming tumultuous. So John enlists as a soldier in the Pennsylvania artillery. He enlists as a matros, which essentially, I guess, is an artilleryman who helps out with cannons. And when he enlists, Margaret goes along with him. It's not necessarily because she was like keen for the fight. It's really just what women did in those days. Because remember, it was dangerous to leave your wife alone at home. I mean, she could get kidnapped and raped, a situation that Margaret was all too familiar with. So Margaret goes along and does what all the wives did. They were, you know, unpaid support staff for the troops. They would wash the men's clothes. They would, you know, they would go onto the field. They would take pitchers of water to cool down the cannons. This is where that term Molly Pitcher comes from. Molly Pitcher wasn't so much a real historical person as she was this role that a lot of women filled in the Revolution. And of course, they would care for the sick and make food for the troops. Now, if you are a woman making food right now, or a feminist man, once you get this goat cheese spread onto your bread, you are ready to add your next ingredient, which would be our bluish purple carrots, our red grape tomatoes. Lastly, I'm gonna top it with a little balsamic vinegar. Now, I'm actually using the blueberry balsamic that I used on my Betsy Ross bite, but any balsamic vinegar will be great. So, back to Margaret. Margaret goes into battle with John. They find themselves at the Battle of Fort Washington. Fort Washington, which is actually just north in Manhattan. And the battle is ferocious. John's role is that he is like cannon man number two. There's cannon man number one who's doing like all the shooting, and John is like his assistant. So the battle is relentless from go. The British are firing on them along with the Hessians, who are like these German guys helping the British out, and very quickly, bam, cannon man number one is down. And John is like, oh shit, I guess I'm cannon man number one. I need a cannon man number two. Margaret, who's, you know, coming over to cool off the cannon, is like, fuck, I guess I'm cannon man number two. So the two of them are going at it and they're shooting at the British, and then suddenly, bam, John is shot dead in front of Margaret. So what does she do? She's like, fuck this! Independence now! And she becomes Cannon Man 1, Cannon Man 2. She mans that cannon, or should I say, womans that cannon, and is just like firing and going like all hardcore. And then, bam! She gets shot. Because obviously, guys, this is not a good place to be shooting from. There are already two dudes lying dead at her feet. So she probably knew that this was, you know, a little bit of a sketchy spot. She gets shot in her rib cage on the left side of her chest. She gets shot in her jaw, and her left arm is nearly severed from this cannon shot. So what does she do? She keeps the fuck on fighting. I know. She keeps shooting with her arm like barely attached, bleeding from, I imagine, just the whole left side of her body, until some other soldiers are like, whoa, this fucking crazy lady over there, you have to get off the field, Margaret. And she's like, nope. And so they have to drag her off the field so she will stop fighting. Right? It's a harrowing fucking story that deserves a cocktail. We are going to make this Amerigin Corbin. Again, it's a riff on an American Collins, which is itself a riff on a Tom Collins. A Tom Collins is a classic cocktail with a long history. There's even a reason, of course, the story behind why it is called a Tom Collins, but we have enough stories about white douchey guys, so you can Google it. What I will tell you is that a Tom Collins is basically any base spirit. In the case of a Tom Collins, in our drink, that's gin, a John Collins, a vodka Collins, of different base spirits. You have your base spirit, you have a sweet mix, normally a simple syrup, a sour mix, normally lemon juice, and then you top it with club soda. So we have all of that in our Ameri-gin Corbin and more. First, we're gonna do a muddle. We're gonna put in like 4 or 5 Bing Cherries. Then we're gonna add in 8 to 10 blueberries. And we're going to put in our sour mix next. We're gonna put in 3/4 of an ounce of lemon juice. And then we're gonna add 1/2 ounce of our simple syrup. Again, I am reusing an ingredient from a previous episode. I am reusing the rosemary syrup that I used in my very first episode about Ruth Bader Ginsburg. It's a delicious syrup, and it's, I think, gonna bring out nicely the rosemary that we've already used on our carrots. So we're gonna pour that in, and then we're gonna do a muddle. Still no muddler. Back of a spoon. Want to really masticate those berries. Something that Margaret Cochran Corbin was scarcely able to do after she had most of her jaw blown off in battle. So after the battle, which incidentally the Americans lost, Margaret is sent to Philadelphia where she convalesces. And this is actually where things get interesting. Like, they weren't interesting before, but like interesting from a feminist perspective. Margaret is essentially disabled after the battle. She has no use of the left side of her body, and she is enlisted in the Army's Invalid Regiment. It's not a real regiment, but a regiment of disabled soldiers who serve the Army in whatever capacity they are able to, given their disability. They're also paid for this service. And Margaret is paid. But let's not get crazy. You know, she's paid half salary. Because she is a woman, after all. And all she did was give up, you know, the use of her left arm and the ability to chew in this battle. So, once this unit is disassembled in 1783, Margaret is still in dire financial straits. But the War Board hears about her situation, and they decide to honor her. They recognize her as a serviceman's wife who has herself rendered conspicuous service. They give her $30 for her clothing that was destroyed during the battle 6 years prior. Thanks for that. But they also, more importantly, give her a stipend to live off of, making her the first woman in history to receive an army pension. Now, her life in West Point after this isn't exactly a picnic. I mean, again, this woman has seen some fucking shit in her life. So she's not exactly like a sweet, benevolent old lady. She's kind of an angry, cantankerous woman who's known about the community for smoking and hanging out with soldiers rather than other ladies. That being said, everyone in West Point treats her with respect. She's referred to by all as Captain Molly. And though they view her as sort of an old, angry widow, unfortunately, that's not even the truth because she never lives to be very old. She died when she was about 48 years old. And is buried somewhere, which is to say that this is not the end of Margaret's story. It is also not the end of our cocktail. So we're going to add to our cocktail shaker 1.5 ounces of gin. You can be pretty liberal with the gin on this one. It's a sipper though, it's not a hard drink. Then we're going to shake it. Now, some people build a Tom Collins in a highball glass and then stir it and top it with club soda. I like to shake it. I want to integrate all of that fruit juice. But for you mixologists out there who are like, no, that's not how you do it. This is my personal preference. We're talking about an independent woman who did whatever the fuck she wanted. I'm doing what the fuck I want with this cocktail. We're going to put 4 or 5 ice cubes into our glass. We're not going to strain it in. I'm telling you, it's an unconventional way of doing it because I want to keep those pieces of fruit in there. It was a dry shake. There was no ice in there. And then we're gonna top it. Ooh, it smells amazing. We're gonna top it with a little bit of club soda. I also have a pretty garnish, a pretty red, white, and blue garnish for it, made with a lemon, a cherry, and some blueberries. So, what happened to Captain Molly? Well, Margaret was buried somewhere near West Point in the Hudson Valley. It's not totally clear. But in 1926, as the sesquicentennial of the Revolution and Margaret's act of heroism came about, members of the Daughters of the American Revolution, of the DAR, decided that her contributions to the war had to be recognized. So they wanted to find her remains and have them properly memorialized, which they did. They find her remains, they're exhumed, they are reinterred at West Point with full military honors. But then there was a disturbance at the gravesite, which led to a full forensic archaeological study, which revealed that that body wasn't Margaret Cochran Corbin's body at all. It was the body of some unknown male soldier, because of course it was. What a shock, a man getting the honor that a woman deserves, a recurring theme in our series that's driving me to drink. Cheers, my friend, let's try this cocktail. It's good, it's nice. You get a lot of the lemon. I'm not always someone who likes pieces of fruit in my cocktail, but I got a blueberry in that first sip slash bite, and it was delicious. I'm really glad that the fruit's there to sweeten up some of those really forward citrus notes that we get from the lemon. Let's try it with our blueschetta. This is also really nice. The goat cheese pairs beautifully with the subtle honey that we put into the carrots, as well as the rosemary that brings both the cocktail and the bite together. It's a beautiful summery pairing. Perfect for, say, 4th of July, where we celebrate mostly the men of the Revolution. The thing is, the women of the American Revolution are unsung, even when they are literally singing the words of Lin-Manuel Miranda. I mean, Margaret herself, her story ends with a question mark. We still don't know where her remains are. But her legacy is lasting. It is seen in the millions of women who have served this country since Margaret first stepped on the battlefield centuries ago. I hope you enjoyed this episode of Feminist Cocktail Hour. I will see you tomorrow. I'm doing 5 episodes back to back this week, just like I did at the very beginning of Feminist Cocktail Hour. It's culminating in my 50th episode the day before my birthday, which is when I'm going to take a little hiatus. So I will be back tomorrow. I will have a new lady, a new libation. Until then, cheers.
Let's go, girls.